But it is my great pleasure to introduce to you this morning Dr. Graeme Elliott. I actually couldn't recognise him when I saw him this morning because he was wearing long trousers and shoes and a suit jacket. And I generally know Graeme to be wearing sandals and shorts right through the middle of winter. Graeme is absolutely dedicated to conservation. Even outside his work with the Department of Conservation, he spends, I swear, every spare breathing moment thinking, acting, and even being a volunteer in terms of conservation. Now, when I asked him what he'd just been doing before he came here, he replies to me that he's just spent 2 weeks down south looking after the kakapo on his 2 weeks holiday. So I think that says to you, obviously, some of the passion that this man has and also the incredible knowledge that he has. Now, whenever I'm looking for an amazing speaker in the top of the South Island, I go, when was the last time we had Graeme speak? And is there something else that we could have Graeme come and speak about now? But it is my great pleasure to introduce you to Dr. Graeme Elliott, who's going to be talking to us this morning about this year's mega mast and the impact that that will have on our native species, and obviously some of the work that's being done by the department to hopefully negate some of those negative impacts. So Graeme, welcome.
Thanks, Debs. Great way to embarrass somebody to start off with, eh? Hey, this was going to have a mega mast in the title, but when I came to put mega on it, I just couldn't do it. It was too much like an advertisement for a hardware shop, so I'm reverting to mast. Okay, so I'm Graeme Elliott. Thanks, Debs, for introducing me. I've been messing around with forest birds for something like 35 years. I started working on these fellows, Mohua and Fiordland, in the early 80s. And I haven't been able to get away from them ever since. And of course, I've been a member of Forest and Bird for 47 years. Yeah. Okay, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to talk about masts in general. So we're going to have Mast 101, and then I'm going to talk about what happens this year, and then I'll talk a bit about what the department's Te Akina Ngā Manu program, the old Battle for Our Birds program, about what we're going to do about the predator plagues that are happening now. Okay, so Mast 101. These are all the native forests we've got left in New Zealand, about 6.4 million hectares. And of those, about two-thirds, about 4 million hectares, have got beech trees in them. So beech trees are the biggie in New Zealand's forests. Even in the north, there's lots of beech trees. And this red stuff is the forests which have got nearly entirely beech. So the picture I'm just trying to paint here is that beech forests are a big deal in New Zealand. They're everywhere. Of course, the thing about beech trees is they don't flower and seed every year. They only produce flowers and seeds once every 2 or 3 years. So this is a mountain beech tree with a few flowers on it. You'll have all seen when the trees go mad, you get bands of orange moving up the hillsides as the trees flower. And here's a picture from Lake Te Anau looking across at Mount Luxmore. All that cloudy stuff on the other side, there ain't clouds, it's pollen. So that's beech pollen. Now, I don't know who took this picture. I stole it off one of my friends in town now. So if they're in the audience, thanks. Okay, so when the beech trees flower and seed, they produce millions of seeds, literally 50 million seeds per hectare when you get a big beech seed fall. And that's 250 kilograms of stuff falling on the forest floor. And you think about that in terms of what we might do with 1080 operation, for example, where we'll sow 1 or 2 kilograms of stuff per hectare. This is 250 kilograms of food going into the system per hectare. It's a massive injection of food, and it has a huge impact on what goes on. There's other masting species, and these are just a couple of them. We've got Remu and Kakatea. These often are mast out of sync with the beech, but this year they've decided all to go off together. So it's a catalogue of disasters, really. So here's the beech forest sort of cycle. Every 2 to 6 years, average of 3 or 4, the beech trees flower. And when that happens, you get plagues of rats and mice. But you often get both. You sometimes get one, you sometimes get the other. Perhaps the most frequent is just plagues of mice, but then every now and then you get plagues of rats instead. And of course, these rodents feed stoats. Now, the reason why you get the plague of rats and mice is because they breed in the winter, which they wouldn't normally do. So when the beech trees seed, there's seed lying around in the winter, and the rats and mice breed all winter. And they provide food for stoats. Stoats have this cunning breeding system where they're pregnant all the time, but the number of babies they give rise to depends on the conditions during the year. So if you have a good year with lots of rats and mice, they produce lots of babies, up to 10 or 14 babies. So in a good year like we're having, we can expect the stoat population to have a sort of 6 or 7-fold increase when the stoat babies are born in the spring. And of course, these things, the stoats and the rats, prey upon birds like morhua, and they decimate them. Give us a bit of a time scale. It kind of goes like this. The seed trees flower and the seeds develop in the spring and summer. The beech seed falls in the autumn. And then there's beech seeds lying on the ground during the winter, and that's key for the rats and mice because they normally don't breed in the winter, but when there's beech seed on the ground, they breed all winter. When the seed runs out or germinates, which is in the spring, their populations stop growing, and they kind of roughly flatline, and the populations go on until the following winter when they crash. Stoats can't do that. They can only breed once a year, so their increases look more like this. And it's this period here, when we've got high numbers of rats, mice and stoats in the system, that our forest birds take an absolute pasting. And so for small forest birds like morhua, it looks like this. They're successful breeders in the year before all this stuff. They do okay. In the year of the high rats and stoats, it's an absolute disaster for them. Then it gets a bit better, and then it goes back to normal. So that's where we're at now. So we're in July, basically, 2019. So the rat and mouse numbers are rising, and the stoat numbers are going to skyrocket up quite soon. For a little bird like a morhua, it goes like this. If you start off with a truckload of morhua, you have let's say you just have a stoat plague. No rats, just stoats, because it's a mouse stoat year. And they'll crash, but they're little forest birds. They can have a lot of babies, and their numbers recover quite quickly. But they never quite get back to where they were before. So over a few of these, they go down. And then if you have a year when there's lots of rats as well as stoats in the system, it's a complete and utter disaster, and it goes like this. So you have these crashes. So for birds like morhua, they're on a slow decline anyway, and in the super bad years when you have a shitload of mice and rats and stoats, you get these crashes. Most of us grey-haired folk will remember the 2000 beech mast, which wiped morhua out of the Marlborough Sounds. Eugenia already mentioned that. And at the same time, the orange-fronted parakeets at Arthur's Pass took an absolute pasting. So it's during these big years that things really go awry. We're having one of those now. So there's a bunch of little animals like this that take a real pasting during these things. So these are all the small forest birds and the two bats. When you have these big masts, these things are vulnerable to local extinction. The other creatures, the larger things like kaka, kia, fia and the kiwis, they're not so vulnerable. Their babies are very vulnerable, but the adults are okay. So during these big masts, these larger animals take a bit of a hit, but they're not at risk of immediate extinction like the smaller ones are. So our response to this stuff is when we're having these widespread masts in lots of backcountry New Zealand, the main tool is aerially applied 1080. There's also a lot of trapping and poisoning in bait stations, but the tool that's used over the largest area of the country is aerially applied 1080. So how does this thing work? Well, I've already shown you this graph, and I'm just going to add possums in. They don't really respond to mast in the same way, so you've got kind of constant numbers. If you do a 1080 operation at the right time, you knock the rats for 6. And if you're a bit lucky, they don't recover because you hit them at the time the seed runs out. So you kill them all, there's nothing left for them to eat, so they don't recover. And that's kind of the perfect case, it doesn't always happen. Stoats don't eat 1080 baits, but they eat poison rats and mice, so their numbers drop out of the system and then they gradually recover over subsequent years. And of course, 1080 is a good possum killing tool. So 1080 applied at the right time gets rid of all these things, and you end up with a relatively low possum, rat and stoat system for quite a long time in some forests, and for much shorter times in other forests. But that's sort of the aim of doing these 1080 operations, is to produce this sort of situation. Now, one of the things that's changed recently is we're able to predict beech mast much better than we used to be able to. We've just, some folk from Canterbury University discovered in about 2012 that you can predict beech mast by the temperatures in the previous two summers. So when you have a warm summer that was preceded by one that was a bit cooler, you're going to have a beach mast. And it doesn't matter the absolute temperatures, it's kind of the difference between the two summer temperatures. So these days we can predict these things rather well. And so in 2014 we had the first crack at this, and you can imagine the colours on that picture are red means panic, there's a big beach mast coming. Dark blue, which there's none of there, means don't panic. So 2014 was a big beach mast year. 2015, there was almost nothing anywhere in New Zealand. 2016 was another, a little bit less than 2014, but it was quite bad. 2017 was a little bit less again, but there were still parts of New Zealand where we had a significant beach mast. And then 2018, nothing. So I'm going to bring up 2019, which is what we're in now, so get ready. It's shocking. Yeah, so it's the biggest one we've had for a long time. So remember, this is just a climate prediction, though. And it's interesting to think about what's going to happen next year. Looks like nothing much is going to be happening next year. So it's going to be super bad this time and fairly moderate around the country next year. Now, we haven't actually got seed assessments for the whole country going back very far, but if you look at this climate data, you can have a bit of a stab at what we think has happened over the last 40 years. And so this is the proportion, these bars represent the proportion of the country in which there was a beach mast, or at least the proportion of the beach forest. And you can see that this year, 2019, is the highest, the most of the country we've ever had involved in a beach mast for 40 years probably. But there have been other years where it's nearly been as bad, but certainly this is the worst. Okay, so that's all about climate prediction. The climate predicts there's going to be a beach seed fall, but it doesn't mean it's going to happen. So what we do to see whether it's going to happen or not is we wait till the seeds have developed, and in February we fly around the country and sample from the tops of trees. And I've got a wee video.
This morning we started off at Nelson Airport. We took off and headed towards the sounds to collect samples of beech and rimu trees in the area. A helicopter approaches a tree and kind of hovers just over the canopy, and one person leans out and with secateurs just clips the top of a tree. The various species of beech that we have in our New Zealand forest and rimu, they produce large amounts of fruit in some years, and these years are called mast years. So what we do is determine how productive the forest is going to be by the samples that we're collecting today. After the samples have been taken back to Nelson, they've been counted and all the data has been collated, then we'll find out for all the sites where we collected samples what the severity of the mast is.
Okay, I have to say, Joris was tied into the helicopter, by the way. He didn't just lean out the door. Okay, is that going to go? Yep. Okay, so these are the places we seed snipped in February 2019. We call it seed snipping. So 144 sites with beech, and we also did samples out of rimu trees at those 54 sites. So just to give you a picture of what it's like, so this is the seed snipping. It's not a climate prediction. This is a measure of the amount of seed in the trees. Our sample is called a handful. It's my hand, 20 centimetres long. You take the first, last 20 centimetres on a branch, rip it off and count the seeds on it. So what it's telling us is it's a disaster. There's a heavy beech seed fall throughout the South Island and throughout a large proportion of the beech forest in the North Island. Have a look at our last big one in 2016, and it pales into insignificance by comparison. Now there's an interesting thing that Mike North, Debs, pointed out that we noticed in Nelson that a lot of the seeds didn't seem to be viable. You went and ripped them open and there was nothing inside them, and we thought maybe the drought that we had in Nelson had an effect. Well, we measure the viability of all the seeds that we, well, a sample of all the seeds that we collect. So this is the pattern of viability that we detected around the country, and indeed in Kaharangi and perhaps in western and southern Fiordland, a reasonably high proportion of the seed wasn't viable. I don't know what quite to make of this, actually, because the seed fall we got was about four times what we got in other times, and yet it was only about 25% viable. So the amount of stuff in the system is probably about the same as a normal beech mast. I'm certainly not confident to say that nothing's going to happen just because there wasn't viable seed. I think something is going to happen. In fact, the rat and mouse numbers are all suggesting it does. But anyway, that's a little bit of interesting science that went on. Of course, the other thing we've got is still all that's predictive. It's not actually about baddies in the forest. We've got a tracking tunnel network of about 30,000 tracking tunnels around the place. There's more going into the North Island as we speak to catch up. And this is what gives us the last word on whether we're having a plague of rats and mice and stoats. So the response to this is the department's Tiakina Ngā Manu program, or Battle for Our Birds as it was. And in 2014, we used 1080 on 660,000 hectares. 2016, a bit more, 784. 2017, 824. And 2019, we're aiming at about a million hectares, okay, and we've got, there's 1.25 million hectares in the bucket, and it'll just depends on which ones actually get to go ahead. And the total picture looks like that. These are the sites that have been treated over the last few years. Now, you're not allowed to get too encouraged about this, because yes, it does look a lot better than what we used to do, but let's stick all the public conservation land on there, and it's 25% of it, and if we just look at the forested public conservation land, we're only treating 33% of it, which means that the other two-thirds we're doing nothing. There's some trapping programs, but they don't add up to much in size. So we need to do more. How does it go? I'm running out of time, so I better go fast. This is the rat killing results in 2014. This is just the stuff from the South Island going from north to south. The blue bars are what we got before we did the 1080 operations, and the red bars are what we got afterwards. You can see at most of the sites, we killed most of the rats. And even at the worst sites, like this one here, which is Springs Junction, we still, these scales don't add up to exactly numbers of rats, but at that site, we still killed about 80% of the rats. So we knocked them for six. We'd like to do better. These red bars are giving us a hint of the places where we've got to figure out what we can do to do a better job. The stoats you can't do before or after, so we've just got treatment, non-treatment, so you don't need to worry about the words along the bottom. But you can see all the ones on the left are those that were treated, all the ones on the right were untreated. We've clearly got a hell of a lot less stoats in our treated blocks. This dude's an interesting one. This is from the Fife near Mount Owen. These weren't stoats, they were weasels. So one of the consequences of doing good stoat control is you might end up with a bit of a weasel problem. So that's another thing for us to get our heads around. So, okay, what is this stuff doing for our forest birds? Well, I'm going to turn it around and say, what would have happened if we hadn't done anything? I think we'd have lost the bats, the long and short-tailed bats from many forests. We've lost Mohor. We'd have lost whatever that one was. I've just forgotten. I pushed the button too quickly. And we'd have lost rock wrens. These are the species that are really, really susceptible to plagues of rats and stoats. These other more common small forest birds, their abundance would have shrunk, as would these larger forest birds. So leave it alone, you can expect local extinctions of those key small bird species like rock wrens, mohor, and the two bats. Do something about it, and you can keep it like that. Just sort of a little bit of an aside, one of the things we've learned over the last couple of years is that big operations seem to be quite advantageous. So this is 312,000 hectares we did in Kaharangi a couple of years ago, and we've measured the reinvasion of stoats back into this block. And they don't just flood back in a bang, it takes them a while. So this is a bit of a schematic of it. But see, after year one, you've still got a hell of a lot of country that's effectively stoat-free, and it takes 3 or 4 years for the stoats to get back in there. So there's a couple of take-home messages in that, is that if you want to keep stoats out for a long time, do it big. But of course, the other message is if you want to keep stoats out of a small block of forest, it's hard work. Some of you will know that. I always get asked, why don't we use traps instead of poison? So here's my, I'm always rolling this out. Most of you will have already seen it probably. Here's an operation we did in the Paparoas a couple of years ago, 70,000 hectares in those three blocks there. Let's do it with traps instead. So to do it with stoat traps, we'd need to put stoat traps out at that density. This is Doc Speck's practice. Okay, I wouldn't stick them on a grid. I'd stick them up ridges and stuff, but that's the density of traps you have to use. It's 7,000 traps. The key is 2,000 kilometres of traps to get between them and 200 person days to get around them. Okay, you sort of go, oh, well, maybe it's possible, it costs squillions, but maybe you could do it. But that's just stoats. You haven't done anything about rats. So here's my rat version. So this is one trap per hectare, which is what you'd have to do. 70,000 traps. That ain't nothing, 7,000 kilometres of traps to get around them. I've spent a bit of time in this country chasing snails, which is one of my hobbies. You ain't doing this. It doesn't matter how much money the minister tips on us, we can't do that one. It's not possible. If you want to get rid of rats and stoats in places like that, you have to do it with techniques that are applied from the air. Full stop. It probably doesn't matter what you use, but you can't do it on the ground. So where does that leave us? Because I've got some land over in Golden Bay, and I want to trap it and muck around like we all do. So what do we do? Well, this is the edge of that Paparoa operation. And this is the bits that DOC's left out from its 1080 operations because we can't do them. There's water supplies, there's private land, there's a multitude of reasons why we don't do it. This stuff would be a sitter for a local trapping program. People could do that. And on that scale, it's just 315 traps or bait stations, 31 cases of traps. You can get round it easily, three people get round it in a day. This is the stuff we can do. It would do two things. It would make the predator abundances around the places we live better, so we'd have more birds in our backyards, and it would protect our big investment in the backcountry by stopping reinvasion from the local stuff. So let's all get out there and do the edges. I just wanted to talk briefly about Bikill, and I'm going to... Oh, we're all right, aren't we? You could talk about this forever. So these are a bunch of species that I've been involved with monitoring over the last 10 years or so to measure the benefits of 1080 and the costs of 1080. So out of all these species, some of them do get killed by 1080. It's a poison. Let's never pretend that we don't kill stuff. It's a poison. So kias, fern birds, robins, and weka, maybe pheo, maybe rock wrens, do occasionally get killed by 1080. But the kaka, the moorporks, the kiwis and the rifleman and the moorhua don't eat the stuff. We've never detected them being killed. So most of those species, it's a no-brainer. They go through the roof when you do 1080 ops. But even those ones that are getting killed, so that's things like wekas and kia, we've studied them to death because people are on our backs all the time, and they're better off with the treatment because stoats, possums and rats kill more of their babies than we ever kill of them with the poison. So things like kia, which are one of the most contentious, kia are destined for extinction if we do nothing. If we use 1080, they will be fine. And that's what we should be doing. I think that's me. All right, yep.
Fascinating as always. If you've ever heard Graeme speak before, I'm sure you'll be glad to be hearing him again. We have got a bit of time for a couple of questions. If we have some, have we got our people on our roaming mics? Yes, we do. Whoever's closest to you there has a start. Yep.
Can you hear me? Okay. No one has mentioned to date genetic engineering, gene drive. I know the Greens are anti it, but is there any future? Because the beach massing is going to get worse with climate change. Your job is going to get harder and harder. Is there any future for something like the gene drive to nobble stoats, rats, etc.?
Well, in my dreams there is. I would love it. But I'm an old cynic and I'm a little bit sceptical that it'll actually happen. But, yep, it's certainly worth some investment in that. But I'm always a bit sceptical about waiting for a technology that doesn't yet exist because it might never come along. So I want us not to concentrate on our dreams of how we might do it, but just do it with the tools we've got and do a bloody good job.
Any more questions down here? Yep.
Is this working?
Yep.
Good. Graeme, you mentioned that the best time to hit with 1080 in a mast year is when the beech seed is on the ground and has started to rot out. But I know that they're doing drops at the moment in Taranaki and down the South Island. Are those drops too early? They have to fit them in when they can.
Yeah, well, there's two things. Yeah, I mean, if you do it very early and you don't do a very good job, you risk a substantial recovery. But if you do it early and do a good job, it's probably fine. So that's what we're trying to do. And there isn't enough time to fit all the operations into the optimal window. So that's just a constraint we can't get around with. Our confidence about the optimal timing, I've sort of portrayed it there as being the best time to go spring. I'm not really sure about that anyway. It obviously makes good sense to get rid of those pests as early as you possibly can. But if it's not going to last, then you might want to leave it longer. But that's an area of constant research for us. So I'm not sure what the right time is. Our notion that it's spring is kind of, you know, our best guess, but we've got to do better.
Cool. We'll just take one more question down the front here.
Oh, kia ora, Graeme. That was really fantastic. Just a really quick question. We've got some snails that you can chase over at the Raukumara. When would your next holiday break be available? We would love you to come over and we would love to have a chat, and so our people will come and talk to your people. Is that the way that we can make that happen?
I've chased those snails, of course.
but seriously, Tina and I would love to come and have a chat with you. Tina ngata, which is translated to snail.
Okay. Yeah.
Thank you, Graeme.
Thank you.